Okay, well, please keep your Bibles open. Turn to Joshua chapter 8. And we're going to look at this really, really epic Bible story, battle story. Now, I don't know about you, any of you caught this week, but the BBC once again managed to land themselves in hot water by questioning whether or not it was appropriate for the MP Carol Monaghan to go to work with a cross on her forehead from Ash Wednesday. Now, we ought not to be surprised that the Beeb should reveal their galactic ignorance of Christianity on a regular basis. That's not the point here. But what I found interesting about this was it made me think about the cross, particularly around Ash Wednesday. But why wear a cross? Why would you do that? Wearing a cross is a sign of shame, isn't it, the cross? Especially in the sense of the tradition that some Christians hold to for Ash Wednesday. You know, a bit of charcoal splodged on your forehead. Nobody wants to go to work with a grubby face, do they? Isn't the cross of Christ a symbol of tortuous and horrendous execution? Why would you mark yourself? It's gruesome. In the tradition that she was upholding, it signifies that man is dead, man is under curse and judgment, destined to die, and save for the cross of Christ alone, there is no hope. Why would you wear a cross? Now the Bible, you may be surprised to know, agrees with the BBC. The cross is foolishness for those who are perishing. But to those who are being saved, it is the power of God. It is the power of God. It's where God's love and his life is revealed so fully. It's where his character and his passion and glory, as we were thinking this morning, is radiated maximally out to the world. It is the heart of Christian theology. It is the pulse of the Christian's living. It is the hope of our glory. The cross of Christ is the racing, surging feeling of joy that wells up within us, that takes us into a place of happy worship. The cross of Christ may seem ugly, shameful, and inappropriate for those who are perishing. But for we who do believe, we gladly bear the reproach of Christ. For at that place, at Calvary, we find ourselves, we realize who we are. We know what we are now in Christ. We find springs of living water. We find hope. We find joy. We find a passion and a meaning to living. It makes sense of the world, its sufferings. The cross of Christ is everything. And now you're thinking, what on earth has that got to do with the battle of AI? Or I? We'll get there, I promise you. Now, we just recap a little bit to find out what we're doing and how we got here. The people of Israel had this amazing victory at Jericho a few weeks ago in the preaching series. The Lord had given the city into their hands. The walls tumbled down and the mighty men of Jericho were routed. The edifice of human strength, everything humanity could put there as a symbol of our greatness and our security, was torn down by the living God, something the BBC ought to bear in mind. Now, the people have been commanded to get rid of everything in Jericho, its inhabitants, the possessions of the city, the livestock, everything. The only thing that they weren't to destroy was gold, silver, and some bronze items, which would all be used in the worship of Israel, the corporate worship. But one guy called Achan got greedy. He took some of those things that the Lord had specified explicitly for the use in the worship service, which would benefit everybody. He took some of those things to benefit himself. He had such a low view of his brothers and sisters and the workings and worship of Israel. His eyes were captured by something of mere earthly beauty. His greed led him to rob God. And as a consequence of that, he robbed his brothers and sisters. Not only that, but Achan also took this fancy cloak from Shinar that should have been destroyed in Jericho, and he brought this item which was devoted to destruction into the camp of Israel. And so one consequence of Achan's sin immediately was that Israel suffered a humiliating defeat the first time they tried to take this city of Ai. That defeat caused Joshua to go before the Lord and lament, "Oh Lord, why has this happened to us? Why have we failed in battle?" And the Lord basically replies, "Get up, isn't it obvious? Why have you failed? You know, someone's transgressed. It's obvious. I told you before Jericho. I told you. I've not brought the defeat at Ai on you. You brought it on yourselves." So Joshua then follows the Lord's clear instructions about how to find out who did the deed. And it was Achan, the one who invited disaster on Israel. He brought this thing devoted to destruction into the camp. And so he brought destruction to the camp. And interestingly, he brought this thing that was under the judgment and curse of the Lord into his own household, with his family. And so Achan and all his household, his whole life, his family, his livestock, his children, the animals, everything was brought into the valley of trouble. And there outside the camp, he was put to death. The destruction he invited onto his household was ultimately met out against it. The wages of sin is death. But chapter 7 ended with a note of hope. It began with the very clear signal that the burning anger of the Lord was directed at the people of Israel because of Achan. But it ends in verse 26 with the anger of the Lord being turned away. The price for sin had been paid. The Lord's anger had been removed. Justice had been done. And so chapter 8, verse 1, and we heard this morning, it's the same again. There is no break. It's just straight in. This is part of the narrative. And we see the immediate effect of the anger of God being turned away from the people. With wrath removed, they hear now in verse 1 words of comfort and peace. Do not fear and do not be dismayed, the Lord says. It's not hard to see why the people might fear and might be discouraged after the Ai incident. And Achan, oh, what now? If we can't even defeat little Ai, and if it's so dependent on us all being so free from sin, if they know themselves and with any honesty think, goodness, I sin every day. What hope have we got? But the Lord is gentle here. He comes and he meets that need, that fear, that discouragement with gentle words of encouragement. So he says, take all the fighting men with you. Arise, go up to Ai. See, I've given into your hand the king of Ai and his people and his city and his land. And you shall do to Ai and its king as you did to Jericho and its king. Only its spoil and its livestock you shall take as plunder for yourselves. That's how he answers fear and discouragement. He answers fear and discouragement by promising great things for our future. Crucially, the crux of this promise here for Joshua is I've done this, Joshua. I've got this. It's on me, this one. I've got it. I will keep the covenant for you. It's a done deal. I've given into your hand the king of Ai, his people, his land. It's going to be just like Jericho. So trust me. You didn't trust me before. Trust me this time. Any fear and discouragement we get at any time, the Lord will answer by saying, don't try and work out your plan of redemption and your salvation for yourself. If you try and justify yourself, yes, you'll be full of fear and discouragement. The reminder is, the Lord does it. The Lord saves. The Lord has got this plan sorted out. I'm giving you Ai. That's his first encouragement. Secondly, he gives them a glimpse of their future inheritance. They're told that this time they will get to keep all of the plunder, the loot for themselves. If only Achan had been patient and waited, trusting the word of the Lord. In the commentary, Dale Ralph Davis I know a number of you have got hold of that commentary for this series. Dale Ralph Davies says, it's only when we lose sight of the generosity of God that the cancer and covetousness of sin consumes us. When we lose sight of the generosity of God. And then he says right from the beginning, the devil wanted man to focus on the restrictions that God had placed in the garden, rather than focusing on the absolute abundance that God had lavished on them. He'd given them the earth. He'd given them everything in it. And Achan, just like his distant relatives, Adam and Eve, and just like us in so many ways, lost sight of the generosity of God. And he got consumed by covetousness and greed. Had he waited and trusted the Lord with his redemption, he'd have enjoyed a rich inheritance in the land, picturing, of course, that ultimate new creation future. And he would have had the taste there by taking some of the spoil. Instead, he shared the inheritance of Adam, which is death. And so verses 1 and 2, this is the Lord's answer to fear and discouragement for Joshua. Comforting words and promises about the future. And the assurance that I've got this. But the fact that the Lord is saying, trust me with this, I've got this, I'm going to hand it over, it doesn't mean that there's nothing for Joshua to do. The divine general gives his plans of attack to Joshua. Although the attack is, we know it's certain. The Lord has said it's going to be certain. There's things for you to do, Joshua, and the people. So in verse 2, we get the bare fact, the long and the short of it, stated for us. Lay an ambush against the city behind it. And then through the narrative, we get some of the detail about what God ordered by way of how to lay this ambush. And, to be honest, the exact detail of how that pans out is still a little bit tricky to ascertain. Were there two ambushes, two ambush groups? One of 30,000 men in verse 3, and another of 5,000 men in verse 12. Did they have different jobs to do in the ambush situation? Perhaps one group was there to burn and pillage and take the plunder, and the other lot were there to fight. That seems possible. That seems likely. I prefer that thought. The other idea is that maybe there was just the one ambush group, and the account in verses 10 to 14 is a summary, almost like a flashback, where the detail is not quite so clear, the numbers are a bit wishy-washy. I don't know, there's no indication of that here. But whatever exactly happened, whatever numbers of people and how many nights they spent here and there and everywhere, I think the detail will remain a mystery. And perhaps that's the point. Because if we knew all the detail about how to do this, perhaps we'd lose sight of the fact that the Lord has said, I've got this. It's in my hands. It's not about you guys. So notwithstanding those potential complications, what we do get is an absolutely amazing battle story. I love this story. Reading it from verse 3. Joshua and all the fighting men arose to go up to Ai, and Joshua chose 30,000 mighty men of valor and sent them out by night. And he commanded them, behold, you shall lie in ambush against the city behind it. Do not go very far from the city, but all of you remain ready. And I and all the people who are with me will approach the city. And when they come out against us, just as before, we shall flee before them, and then they'll come after us until we've drawn them away from the city. For they will say, they're fleeing from us just as before. So we will flee from them. Then you shall rise up from the ambush and seize the city, for the Lord your God will give it into your hand. And as soon as you've taken the city, you shall set the city on fire. You shall do according to the word of the Lord. See, I have commanded you. Verse 9, so Joshua sent them out, and they went to the place of ambush and lay between Bethel and Ai, to the west of Ai. But Joshua spent that night among the people. This is a genius plan. This is brilliant. One of the things we do know for sure, one of the details of what happens, is that the king of Ai notices the main encampment where Joshua and all the rest of Israel are in front of the city. Verse 13. Was spotted by the king. And then verse 14 we read, as soon as the king of Ai saw this, he and all his people, the men of the city, hurried and went out early to the appointed place towards the Arabah to meet Israel in battle. But he did not know that there was an ambush against him behind the city. That being the nature of ambushes, he didn't know. And Joshua and all Israel pretended to be beaten before them and fled in the direction of the wilderness. Run away, run away. So all the people who were in the city were called together to pursue them. And they pursued Joshua and they were drawn away from the city. Not a man was left in Ai or Bethel who did not go out after Israel. They left the city open and pursued Israel. Suckers, they bought it, didn't they? Hook, line and sinker. And they left the city totally exposed. And then verse 18, this strange javelin thing. It's a reminder to us that this is the Lord's battle. He is with his people. In their first attempt to go and conquer Ai, it was clear because of Achan's sin, the Lord's anger burned against them. He was not with them. But now he is, and he's got a plan. He's in the trenches with his general, Joshua. He's with his people. Even for a city as small as Ai, the people must be reminded they are utterly dependent on the presence of the Lord. They are utterly dependent on God in everything, even down to the timing of when to stop running away, when there's sufficient distance between the army and Ai in the city. So when that's all in place, the Lord instructs Joshua. Not now, not now, not now. Now raise it. Up it goes. The javelin goes up and he points it towards the city. That's the signal for the ambush. And at this, the men lying out in the west then rushed in and torched the city. And when both the fighters of Ai and Joshua and Israel saw the fact that the smoke was rising up, that the city was on fire, they knew at that point it's game over. It's game over for Ai. Israel has them surrounded, verse 22. And Ai and all its people were struck down by the edge of the sword, and not one person, bar the king, was left alive. 12,000 people fell under the judgment of the Lord. Verse 18 and verse 26 bookend this battle for us with the javelin thing. The Lord is with them, the success of the battle. And it reminds me very much of what happens with Moses when they faced the Amalekites in Exodus 17. Joshua had to raise high his spear for the duration of the battle. And in Moses' battle, he was to keep his arms outstretched with the staff, the rod of the Lord, lifted up for the duration of the battle. In both cases, it's a symbol, a strange symbol for sure, but a symbol of the Lord's presence with them. He is with them in battle. He will give them the victory. And secondary to that, I also think it serves as a subtle reminder to us, but also principally to Israel in the day, that Joshua was Moses' worthy successor. You listen to Joshua. Don't mess with him. He's just like Moses. Well, the battle's over. The Lord, of course, is victorious. And true to form and true to his word and his goodness in keeping his promises in verse 2, the people are allowed in verse 27 to take the plunder from the city. The Lord doesn't want to impoverish his people, no. As they take their inheritance, then when they're taking their inheritance, that's when they start receiving their reward. Achan had jumped the gun, hadn't he? He'd been watching too many prosperity gospel preachers on cable TV. God does want to bless us. He does want to prosper us. He does want us to be healthy and glad, but it's something we must wait for. It's a happy byproduct of our eternal inheritance in Christ, which we'll enjoy forever in the new creation. Achan had an overrealized eschatology. He wanted everything now. And so he hid his gold under his mattress. The last thing we read about this battle of Ai is all about the king. He must face the same end as the king of Jericho. Reminds us that to enjoy life forever in the new creation, the restored earth, all that is evil has to be cleansed. so that all that is left behind is what is good and what is righteous. The goats, the unbelievers, are cast off into the outer darkness, and the meek inherit the earth. And so here, in this, again, mini picture of final judgment, we've got to see that the wicked being dealt with is part of that scheme. It is justice. So, verse 29, Joshua hanged the king of Ai on a tree until evening. And at sunset, Joshua commanded, and they took his body down from the tree and threw it at the entrance of the gate of the city and raised over it a great heap of stones, which stands there to this day. The practice of hanging the king on a tree outside the city, this was actually a very common wartime practice, very somber, solemn thing to do throughout the region. It probably happened to the king of Jericho, although that's not recorded in chapter 6. It says here, do likewise to the king of Ai. It certainly happened here. And then in chapter 10, we'll see that it happens to the five Amorite kings of the Amorite coalition. They too were hung on trees. There's a book by K.L. Younger with a really, really smooth title, A Study of Ancient Near Eastern and Biblical History Writing. And in that book, he points out this is a common practice throughout the region, Assyria, Egypt, the whole of that region in the day. But Joshua was actually really only concerned with the law of the Lord here, not in, you know, getting on with the same sort of practices that they all had. We see here a clear fulfillment of Deuteronomy 21, verses 22 to 23. Joshua knew that the king and the city were under the curse of God, and so he has to hang the king on the tree. The king is cursed, the city's cursed, so he hangs the king on the tree. And Deuteronomy 21, verse 22, if a man has committed a crime punishable by death, and he is put to death, and you hang him on a tree, his body shall not remain all night on the tree, but you shall bury him the same day, for a hanged man is cursed by God. You shall not defile your land that the Lord your God is giving you for an inheritance. So in accordance with that injunction in Deuteronomy 21, Joshua takes the body of the king of Ai down off the tree before sunset and buries it so that the land and the place they've just won doesn't get defiled. He wants to secure their inheritance for them and not have it defiled. We've been there before. We've seen what happens when we mess with our inheritance. Furthermore, Joshua will be aware of Numbers chapter 5, verses 1 to 4, which speaks about putting all the unclean people outside the gate, outside the camp. That's where these kinds of solemn judgments should take place, so that the curse of God is not brought into the camp, into this place, into their city. Again, we've been here before, and he does not want to repeat it. And of course, we read in Leviticus chapter 4 that when the sin offering was made for the whole people of Israel, the parts which were not used were going to be burned up outside of the camp. So the judgment of Ai, it's got to be seen in this, the king of Ai has to be seen in this symbolic way, this act of crucifying the king outside the city gate, being hung on the tree, was deeply symbolic that the curse of God was on him and his city. Being taken outside the gate, again, this is a clear reminder. This is about purification from sin. This is so that they don't defile their inheritance. Both the king of Ai and Achan were taken outside the gate to a place of execution, and they bore the reproach of their people. For the one man's sin, for the nation's sin, one man, Achan, is killed outside the city gate and buried under a heap which is there to this day. And it turned away the wrath of God from the nation. But for the nation's victory this time, the king who is under the curse of God is hung on a tree outside of the city. His body is taken down and buried before sunset, and there's a heap of stone, and it's there to this day. And so those heaps of stones would serve the people as constant reminders of the cost of their victory, the sinfulness of sin, the curse of God, constant reminders of these things. Israel, every time they saw Ai and those two piles of stones, this is what it took to get us our inheritance. We remember Achan and we remember Ai's king. The place of execution, the place of curse, where sin is dealt with, where the price is paid, it needs to be reminded to the people constantly. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 11 says this: "For the bodies of those animals whose blood is brought into the holy places by the high priest as a sacrifice for sin are burned outside the camp." That's Leviticus 4. Sacrifice for sin outside the camp. But then verse 12: "So Jesus also suffered outside the gate in order to sanctify the people through his own blood." Jesus Christ, the King of the Jews, is hung on a tree outside the gate of Jerusalem, a sacrifice for sin, so that his blood could then sanctify all those who trust. It was a clear signal, wasn't it? They asked Jesus, "Jesus, are you the King of the Jews?" "It is as you say." And so they make a sign and they nail it above his head on the cross, which said, "The King of the Jews." And there he hung, the king, cursed on the tree for the kingdom's sin and for their victory. The king is hung on the tree outside of the gate to sanctify the people. At that time, the Son of God bore the curse of God on the cross, on that judgment tree, as we read in Galatians 3, verse 13, "Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, 'Cursed is everyone who hangs on a tree.'" 1 Peter 2:24, "He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed." And Acts 13:29. "When they carried out all that was written of him, they took him down from the tree and laid him in a tomb, but God raised him from the dead." It's clear what is happening at the crucifixion of Jesus. It is no accident. Just as in Ai, that place of judgment and the stony grave were a lasting sign of the Lord's judgment and victory, so too for us, the cross of Christ and the empty tomb are a lasting sign of the Lord's judgment and victory. For the Israelites, it was the beginning of the end. Sorry, the end of the beginning. The end of the beginning of their journey towards their inheritance. Jericho and these both battles with Ai were the first, and it's the only time we get a full detailed list of what happened and how. These are markers laying down in literally in the ground as reminders for the people. Israel, this is what happens when you obey the word of the Lord and what happens when you don't. The heaps of stone, lasting reminders that God takes sin in the body very seriously. The next thing that happens in Joshua chapter 8, we'll hear about this next week, is that they renew the covenant. Renewal of the covenant. The people worship. The centrality of that gospel, that covenant, is re-established, and the people respond in praise. The writer to the Hebrews, having made clear to us the clear link of the sin offering and Jesus suffering outside of the camp, he goes on to speak of the response of the church to these solemn things. Verse 13 says, "Therefore, let us go to him," Jesus, outside the camp and bear the reproach he endured. For we have no lasting city, but we seek the city that is to come. It's our inheritance. Through him, then, let us continually offer up a sacrifice of praise to God, which is the fruit of lips that acknowledge his name. Our response to our King being crucified, sanctifying us with his blood as we journey towards our inheritance, our response is to die to self, to go to that place of execution, to bear the same reproach that Christ bore. Jesus said, anyone who does not take up his cross daily and follow me cannot be my disciple. Sure, we're not dying to self in order to save anyone or to save ourselves. Jesus' death was unique. But if the cross of Christ is our salvation, and it is, then we bear it with pride. We hold dear to it the scorn of the world, whatever they may throw at us for wearing or loving the cross of Jesus Christ. And our daily act of humiliation, our daily worship of humbling ourselves and dying to self for the sake of others. We do that because, Hebrews 13:14, we have no lasting city, but we're looking for the city to come. We journey on towards our inheritance, not focused like Achan on the things of this world. And so that eternal perspective enables us, doesn't it, to hold so loosely to money and possessions and time and forsake ourselves, live crucified lives, dead to sin, alive to Jesus Christ. And dying to self and bearing the reproach of Christ every day, that's not a joyless thing at all. To be joined to Jesus in his death, quite the opposite. There is nothing which would fill us with more joy, with more happiness, and more hope than the cross of Christ. Because our curse is dealt with, and our sin is dealt with, and by his blood and by his wounds we are healed, and our sin is washed away, and we are cleansed. All unrighteousness washed away. We stand there at the cross with our King in that place of shame with happy hearts because it is our life. It is our salvation. Which is why the writer to Hebrews goes on to say in verse 15 that through Christ being joined to him in his death, we are able now to continually offer up to God this sacrifice of praise and the fruit of our lips, the acknowledgement of his name. Worship of the living God is the fruit of our reflection upon the cross of Christ. Praise is the outworking of salvation, isn't it? It's one of the wonderful, wonderful gifts to the church. Doxology is the action of theology, as the saying goes. So we sing, we praise him, and we worship him with our whole lives, not just on a Sunday, but every day of the week. We sing, as we will do just in a minute, I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior on that cursed tree, his body bound and drenched in tears. They laid him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all alone. The response, oh, praise the name of the Lord our God. Oh, praise his name forevermore. For endless days we will sing your praise. Oh, Lord our God.